This morning and say hello, and then find a complete stranger and say hello with the same excitement and energy and smile this morning. Let's remain standing and sing, "This is our God."
Turn your wasted years. This is our God.
upon his name.
Here at First Centenary, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to worship. I know you were greeted when you came through the door, and I hope you received a worship handout. I want to share a few announcements with you and opportunities and ways that you can plug into the life of the church here at First Centenary. The first thing I want to ask is, if you're sitting on the edge of the row and there's a black attendance pad laying at your feet, if you would pick that up and sign your name, an email address, a phone number, and pass it down your row so that we might continue to stay in touch and to support each other through this thing that we call life and this journey that we call faith. If you're visiting with us, out this door and to the right after the service, there'll be some folks at a visitor station. It's not the station with coffee, but the other table, and they would love to meet you, to introduce themselves to you, and to share with you a little bit about what makes this church so special. Some announcements from your bulletin. This Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. It's a day that begins the season of Lent, a season of preparation for Easter. And we will have two services here at the church, one at noon and one at 6 p.m. We'd love to see all of your faces there as we begin this journey together. And then during the season of Lent, we will be doing a church-wide study on Dietrich Bonhoeffer's The Cost of Discipleship. That study is going to go along with my sermons leading up to Easter about what it means to be a follower of Jesus, but we're going to dig into this theological work a little bit. And those sessions are going to happen on Wednesdays. One will happen at 7 a.m. at my favorite coffee shop in town, my second office, as I call it. And so if you would love to come join me out in community, that information is there in the bulletin, and I'll be there Wednesday mornings from 7:15 to 8:15. And then here at the church at noon and at 6 p.m., there'll be two other discussion groups. So I hope on Wednesdays you can find a time to spend a few moments in community and in study and in fellowship together. There's also some information about ways that you can support our Costa Rica mission trip that's coming up over spring break. If you can respond financially, there's a wish list that they have there, but certainly to remember that trip in your prayers as they are preparing to go down there and join in with the home that we've been working with there for years. I'm going to invite the kids to come and join me up front for a moment of children's church before they are dismissed with Mr. Dillon. I think Miss Beth might wring my neck if I failed to mention that we are preparing for an Easter egg hunt. And if you've never been a part of that, there are thousands of eggs that need to be stuffed with candy. And so if that is a skill that you have of stuffing eggs or providing candy, she would love to put that skill to good use. And her information is there in the worship handout. How's everybody doing? Good? Have you all ever heard any stories in the Bible about a guy named Moses? Yeah? What can you tell me about Moses? Nothing? Huh? Was he the one that parted the waters? Yeah, good job. Yeah, what else? He lived in Egypt. Yeah, that's where he grew up. So this morning, the passage that I'm going to read to all of the adults happened when Moses had already received the Ten Commandments. Have you heard the Ten Commandments? Yeah, Moses was the one who talked to God to receive those. And he was still up around a mountain. How many of you have ever been up on a mountain? He was near a mountain called Mount Sinai. And that's where God would come and talk with him. And he stayed up on that mountain for how long? Can you guess?
A long time.
A long time. That's a great guess. Huh? 40 days. What a great guess you had there. He stayed up there for 40 days and talked to God. And God gave him all kinds of advice and wisdom on what it would look like to be his follower. Who are you and I supposed to follow? God. And who else? Jesus. Jesus. Good answer. And just like Moses stayed for 40 days and 40 nights up on the mountain, sometimes you and I are going to have to be very dedicated and to make the choice to stay with Jesus. And so that's what I want us to remember today. Do you think we can remember that? That throughout our lives, we've got to stay with Jesus. Can you say that with me? Throughout our lives,
we need to
stay with Jesus. All right. Will you pray with me? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us to choose to stay with you today and all the days of our lives. Amen. All right, if you're going to go with your parents, you can go back. Or if you're going to go with Mr. Dillon to Children's Church, you can go with him.
This time I want to invite our ushers to come forward and receive our offerings this morning. I would like to also invite each of you to have a moment during this next song. Maybe it's your moment for the morning. Maybe it's a moment for the week. Maybe it's your moment for a lifetime. This is just one of those sweet and beautiful songs that is simple, but the words are so powerful. It's called What a Beautiful Name.
Yours is
known you for years but has wandered recently can come back to the fold. Oh God, the amazing opportunity of a single hour in your house with other believers. May we not let it pass us by each week, but enter this place with the expectation that you are going to do something huge in our lives and in those sitting around us. Oh God, we thank you. We love you. We acknowledge your presence in this place this morning, and we pray this prayer and all of our prayers in the name of the one who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come.
Would you all join me in just saying thank you to the band and the computer folks and sound folks and I know like me that your lives are blessed by their offering of who they are and where they are on their spiritual journey and how they share that. And so Jeff, band, I'm thankful. So are the rest of these folks, and we give thanks for who you all are. I got a text message or a Facebook message this morning from Samuel, the pastor that we're working with in Romania, and technology's great when it works, right? And Samuel said, I just wanted to share some good news on a Sunday with you. And I was like, that's great. I love good news. And he said, two of the boys from the soccer ministry that you and Barry and Chris played soccer with that day, they came to church this morning and accepted Christ for the first time. And so that had probably very little to do with Barry and Chris and I and everything to do with the work of God in their lives up until that point. But lives are being touched there, and I'm thankful that you all are a part of that and you're supporting that. And on an even happier note, Samuel's youngest little girl, he said, and Daria came up too. And so his youngest daughter received Christ this morning. And so I give thanks for the work of that man and his wife and their ministry together and the ministry in the Roma villages and in the Cluj area of Romania. This Wednesday marks Ash Wednesday, and for those of you who might not be familiar with that, Ash Wednesday is a holy day in the life and the history of the church that marks the beginning of the season of Lent, and Lent historically is a season of penitence and preparation. It's a season that was intended to mirror the 40 days of Jesus when Jesus was wandering through the deserts in preparation for his life of ministry. It's a season and a gift to you and me to spend time thinking about what the life of Jesus really means in our lives. It's a season that is a gift for you and I to approach Easter as transformed people, as people who have been offered new and redeeming life. This has been a part of our history as Christians as early as the late second or early third century. A church historian named Tertullian wrote down that the confession of sins should be joined with the marking of ashes and the wearing of sackcloth. And as early as the 10th century, late 9th, early 10th century, we see this marking of ashes joining this penitent season of Lent. And so when we join together in a celebration like this, we're joining together with 1,000 to 2,000 years of church history and tradition and saying, God, we're not there yet. We've got a little work to do. We realize that we've messed up and we've not loved you with our whole heart, but we want to. And we're willing to work on it if you're willing to help us. I told you earlier that during this season as a church, we're going to be spending some time in talking about what it looks like to live as a follower of Jesus. And one of the guides that we're going to use for that is Dietrich Bonhoeffer's Cost of Discipleship. And Bonhoeffer was born in 1906. He was executed by the Nazi German state in 1945, just a few months before the end of the war, for treason and an assassination attempt that he was associated with on Hitler's life. And Bonhoeffer is, in my opinion, one of the great theologians of the 20th century. And this book works through Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And many scholars believe that those chapters in Matthew 5 and 6 and 7 were actually kind of a calling card that Jesus was putting forth to his disciples, to his followers, to say, this is what it really looks like. I know you heard me on the seashore. I said, come and follow me, and you did, but you might not have understood exactly what I was saying to you. And so this is your get off now. This is heading to the cross. This is about to get really difficult. Many scholars believe that it was the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus was really laying out what he expected from the people who would call him rabbi and teacher. I mean, you've read it a lot, right? You have heard it said this, but I tell you this. And during Lent, we're going to really dig into Matthew 5 and 6 and 7 to reflect on what it is to be a disciple of Jesus. And I hope to share with you in the studies on Wednesdays, but also in worship, some of Bonhoeffer's writings and sayings about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And Bonhoeffer was a leader in the confessing church in Germany, and that was an effort to resist the domination of the Nazi regime to take over the church. And they were using the church as a vehicle to spread their propaganda and hate, to give validation to their actions. And Bonhoeffer said, no, that is not the gospel. That is not what Jesus is about. And he had studied and was a strong proponent of nonviolent resistance and pacifism. He was teaching up pastors to stand up for the gospel and the name of Christ in the face of Nazi Germany. And at a certain point, ended up participating in an assassination attempt on Hitler's life that failed because he had reached a point where the violence that he saw outweighed even his call to nonviolent resistance. One of my favorite passages from Bonhoeffer's writings in general, but specifically this book, has to do with grace. And if you've been a part of a Methodist church before, if you've heard me speak before, you know I'm a big fan of grace, and I'm thankful for God's grace. And Bonhoeffer makes a distinction between cheap grace and costly grace. He says, cheap grace is the preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance, baptism without church discipline, communion without confession, absolution without personal confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Jesus living and incarnate. Costly grace, he says, is the gospel which must be sought again and again, the gift which must be asked for, the door at which a man must knock. Such grace is costly because it calls us to follow, and it is grace because it calls us to follow Jesus Christ. It is costly because it cost a man his life, and it is grace because it gives a man the only true life. And so my question for us this Lent, my hope for us is that we would begin to ask our own hearts and our own lives, what does it look like to live with discipleship in Chattanooga in 2017? What does it look like for me to live as a disciple of Jesus Christ here and now? It probably looks a lot like a season of waiting. Probably looks a lot like sacrifice and difficulty. It might even look like a time of isolation and loneliness. In Exodus 24, a few chapters after Moses has received the Ten Commandments, we hear these words. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and wait there. I'll give you the stone tablets with the instructions and the commandments that I have written in order to teach them." So Moses and his assistant Joshua got up, and Moses went up to God's mountain. Moses said to the elders, "Wait for us here until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur will be here with you. Whoever has a legal dispute may go to them." Then Moses went up to the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The Lord's glorious presence settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, the Lord called to Moses from the cloud. To the Israelites, the Lord's glorious presence looked like a blazing fire on top of the mountain. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain, and Moses stayed on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. The people of Israel had been in the wilderness for over 3 months. They had fled from Egypt, and they had arrived at Mount Sinai. They had gone through the trial of not having enough food and water to eat and drink. And upon arriving at Mount Sinai, they began a season of communing with God, of hearing from God what God expected from those who would follow after him, what God expected from God's people. It was during that time that Moses was presented with the Ten Commandments, that Moses was given the instructions for the Ark of the Covenant and for the tabernacle that would travel with the people of Israel through the wilderness until they settled. Scripture says that Moses was there for 40 days and 40 nights. Did you hear how one of the little boys during children's time knew 40 days? I mean, that's kind of a random number for a 7-year-old to throw out, right? But that's a pattern that we've seen in Scripture. Where else have we seen 40 days in Scripture? Christ's temptation. The flood. Those are two of the biggest examples of the use of the number 40 in Scripture. And the number 40 in Scripture usually represents a season of preparation or purification. Think about the flood and those who were saved from the flood. Noah was saved because he was good, right? He was pure. He was the best of those who were on earth at the time. And Jesus, while he did not need purification, entered into a season of prayer and fasting so that when he would begin his earthly ministry, he would be ready to give all that he had. 100% of his humanity and 100% of his divinity. All of who he was for you and for me. Now think about those times of preparation and cleansing, of sacrifice and self-denial. Think about those individuals who were drawn closer to God in those seasons. And I say to you that you and I are about to be given a gift of 40 days. The season of Lent lasts from Ash Wednesday to Easter morning, and it's 40 days, not including Sundays. I wonder if you and I were to begin to expect transformation during this season. If we were to expect God to show up and to transform, to cleanse and renew our lives and our hearts. I wonder if we began to approach this season with the sacrificial heart of Jesus, what this time, what this period might do for you and I. The practice of Lenten disciplines, the practice of choosing activities that help us live as disciples, that show us what it is to sacrifice and to take small steps, provide us with opportunities to question and to search and to grow. Ultimately, a season like this offers us the chance to be transformed by the resurrected Christ, whether in the first time or the 90th. Last year I showed us a video as we were preparing for Lent, and I was going back through in my computer, and that came up as a suggested video, and I thought, no, this is too good not to share again. And so we're going to watch a video here in a second that I hope springs up in your mind a question about what discipline am I being called to this year? How am I being called to live out my discipleship here and now during this season of Lent and beyond?
Lent's a wonderful season of the Christian calendar. I think it's full of, it's easy to mess it up. And one of the ways in which I think Lent gets messed up is if we experience it as an exercise in deprivation. It's like we should give up something for Lent, as if in God's family, scarcity is a value. And a lot of us have already lived lives of scarcity, where there's not enough, you can't get enough, whatever it is, enough love, enough cocaine, enough whatever. Life is already about not enough. And here, this Christian community says, well, let's practice more, not enough. And I think that's profoundly counterproductive. I learned a lot about Lent from my wife, who one year decided for Lent. We, over a course of years, decided to take Lent more seriously. And one year, she decided to give up shame for Lent. And the notion is, why not give up something that's really killing you, you know? Something that's really a burden that you don't need, that nobody needs. Give up shame for Lent and just try for a week and see what that feels like. Now, I can pretty much guarantee you won't be done with giving up shame by the end of Lent's done, but that's not the point. The point is to have an experience of what life might be like if you were a shame-free person. You may only get a hint at it the first time through. You may be that all you get is you sort of see with more clarity how much shame you're carrying, but that would be a gift. That would be having something you didn't have before. And if there is any sort of dynamic of hope for living with less shame, that'd be a lot to show for a week, you know? I don't expect a lot to happen in a week. I used to pray for that God would let me have problems that could be solved in 2 weeks intensives or 1 week kinds of stuff. And all my stuff is like long-term slogging through it kind of stuff. But Lent's a good practice. It can give you sense of hopefulness. It maybe all it will give you is this sense that I don't have the power to get rid of this by myself. Well, that would be a huge gift to walk away from. Lent, you would have something. And that's I think, the key here, is that Lenten practices should leave us in a spot where we've got more than we started with, not less. So don't give up something that you love. You give up something that's dragging your life down, something that's making your life have less resurrection in it. Because that's what Lent's to prepare us for, a life that where there's more, not a life where there's less. I think most of us, certainly most of us who were raised in profoundly dysfunctional homes, have got all the scarcity we need. We've got that in our bones, we've got that in our guts. We never feel like we deserve much of anything. And so make Lent a time to experience some of the richness of God's love for you. That'd be a really good Lenten practice. Give up shame, give up fear, give up self-loathing, give up self-harm, just for a week, and see if there aren't new possibilities at the end of that week that you're ready for. It makes you ready for Easter. Things actually could be different. That'd be a good thing. If you just get deeper into scarcity, it's going to make you ready for the doing more of the stuff you're already doing, probably. You know, living a life of scarcity. And it's supposed to prepare you for more rather than less. The whole spiritual practice of confession, I think, is like that. It opens you up. It doesn't feel good to be opened up. Like that text in Ezekiel about God taking away your stone heart and giving you a flesh heart. It opens you up to live in a different kind of way in life, a more ready for resurrection kind of life. That's a good thing.
When I think about what it looks like to live as a disciple of Jesus, I think it starts by one person, by you and me saying, God, I need you. And I realize that there are things going on in my heart and in my life that keep me from experiencing the goodness of who you are, that keep me from being fully present with who you are. You've had that experience in relationships here on earth, right? You're talking to your spouse or your significant other, and they're just not there. You've been there, and you realize that they've got something going on in their life, whether it's the stress that they brought home from work, or whether it's a difficulty with a family scenario, or whatever it may be, that they're just not present with you. You've seen that, right? Maybe that's you, and you're the one that's not present, that you struggle with being fully there, and you have to consciously say, no, in this moment, I'm going to be here with you, and I'm going to push aside all other things so that you and I are together. And I think the same is true for God. Sometimes in our relationship with God, the busyness of the rest of our life prevents us from just being present, just being there with God. So my hope and my prayer for each of us this Lent is, as we begin this season, this journey towards the cross, and ultimately this journey towards resurrection, is we would identify those things that keep us from being fully present with God. Because those are the things. Ultimately, those are the things that keep us from truly living as a disciple of Christ. And maybe, like the video said, what you need to give up for Lent is not chocolate or soda, but maybe it is shame. Maybe it is guilt. Maybe it's self-loathing. Looking at yourself in the mirror saying, if only I could lose 10 more pounds, then I would be pretty. Maybe it's not anything physical at all, but if I could do this, then I would be successful. If I had this in my life, then he might really love me. Whatever it is, wherever you are in your life, in your spiritual journey, to find that thing. And if you're like me, there's more than one thing. You've got a bunch of things going on in your life that are really good at popping up and preventing you from being fully present with God. But to find that one thing that you can identify and you can say, all right, God, this is what I need some help giving up this land. Not for me, but so that I can be fully present with you. Will you join me? Will you join me as we journey over the next 40 years and or next 40 days? And I mean, it's probably going to be more like a 40-year journey. As we journey through these 40 days and really dig in to see how you and I are each called to live as disciples here and now. By identifying what needs to go, so that we can offer ourselves to the only thing that really needs to stay. Will you join me on this journey towards discipleship? Will you pray with me? God, we recognize that this journey that we call faith and life, it's not a 40-day thing. That it is a day in, day out, lifelong commitment. A day in, day out of struggle, of not doing it good enough, of messing up again, of wondering if we'll ever get it right or if you're eventually going to give up on us. And God, we admit that it is easier to give up than to continue down the path of discipleship. It's easier to rest in our humanity and say we're not good enough than it is to rest in your grace and say, God, you are more than enough. And so as we begin this season of Lent, God, as we reflect on this call to discipleship, we ask that you would empower us by your Spirit to live and to love ourselves and others with the love that you've offered us through your Son, Jesus Christ. It's in his name that we pray.
Here are my doubts. Here
I think the church has gotten away from the season of Lent and talking about this time of penitence and preparation because it's easier to think that we can do it all on our own. It's easier to just say, well, I've got strong shoulders, I can get through this, than it is to say, God, I surrender to you. I give up my greed and my self-loathing and my hatred. I'm giving up my loneliness. God, I need your help to fight through this depression. I hope that you will turn to Jesus this Lent. That you will allow him to begin to work in you and transform you so that on Easter, you might experience resurrection in a new and vital way. That we might be little Christ to enter into this world and into this city to live and to show light for all who we might encounter. Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. Those who remain in me and I in you will bear much fruit. And apart from me, you will bear nothing. Let's stay connected to him. Let's be transformed. Let's bear fruit. Go in peace to love God and to serve your neighbor. Amen.
I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on you. Oh. I cast my cares on. I cast my cares on.